Now we've just looked at the left and right distributive properties if we combine two operations. Don't get the left and right distributive mixed up with each other. Now the way that we structure this course, really remember, is we're just building the stool set. We're just building definitions, understanding new concepts, and we put them inside of that, review them often so that we know about all of these. When we have our toolbox full, then we're going to start looking at the interesting things. At the moment, I do understand it's a bit difficult. It's all loose concepts. And the next concept is actually quite a big one, isomorphism. And but we're going to talk about isomorphism, but really we don't have anywhere to hang this yet. But once we've built our vocabulary, it'll be so much easier to look at the grammar when we learn this language of abstract algebra. So let's just work through this next concept called isomorphism, pack it away in your toolbox, and we're going to pull it out later when things become really interesting. Now I'm going to read to you, if I can, I'm going to put this on the screen as well. Listen very carefully. If we consider an algebraic system, S, that is our algebraic system, if we consider that to be the following, it's a set and all the relations and operations on those sets. So the set, all its relations and operations, that's an algebraic system. Now, if we consider two such algebraic systems, S and T, we consider them isomorphic algebraic systems. If there is a one-to-one correspondence between them, that's number one, and number two, any relations and operations defined on the sets are preserved in this correspondence. So read that again. I'll stop the video here. It's going to continue on for you, but I'm going to write two such systems on the board, and we're going to go through these things step by step. Now let's tackle this, as I said, piece by piece. I've got two sets on the board here. I've got my set A sub 1 and A sub 2. A sub 1 has 4 elements, A sub 2 has 4 elements, and they are unordered. In other words, it might have been 2, 4, 1, 3, 4, 3, 2, 1. And the same with these. There's no particular ordering, just because it's alphabetical, and an order of the natural numbers, don't read anything into that. They are unordered. Now let's just consider these one-to-one correspondence. I'm going to do a mapping of a one-to-one correspondence. Remember, mapping, it's like what we used to say, a function of the f of x equals x squared. So for every x, I now map to an x squared. I'm mapping real numbers to real numbers. That kind of, that's a function, but now we're calling it mappings because mapping is much more interesting. Now you can well imagine that there are 24 mappings with a one-to-one correspondence. Now here's one such mapping, just one of those 24, and I'm going to call it my alpha mapping. In functional notation, that would be the, like the f of alpha, something like that. But the alpha mapping, it maps 1 to p in a one-to-one correspondence, so 1 to p, 2 to q, 3 to r, and 4 to s. That'd be one of the 24 valid one-to-one, or mappings at least with one-to-one correspondence. Now, let's bring in a relation on A1 and a relation on A2. My relation on A2, it is ordered by, and what I'm going to do with this relation is to order these two unordered sets. So for A2, I'm going to order it by the following relation. R to S, S to P, and R to Q as well. So R goes to Q and S, and S goes to P. I've just decided that is the relation, and I could call this relation something, you know, that fancy R2, that's my relation there. On A1, I'm going to do another ordering relation, and that is going to be is divisible by, so divides. And let's start that ordering. So 1 definitely divides 2, because 1 goes into 2, or 2 over 1, there's no remainder. 2 definitely divides 4, and 1 also divides 3. 3 certainly doesn't divide 2, 2 doesn't divide 3, 3 doesn't divide 4, 4 doesn't divide 3. Divides means there's no remainder if I do that division. So I've got this ordering here. This is my ordering by this relation, relation ordering, and this is my other relation that gives me order. Now consider my following, another one of my two mappings that give me one-to-one correspondence. So 1 to R, 2 to S, 3 to Q, and 4 to P. So you can well see that that is different from this one. Now, does this mapping B preserve the ordering? that this relation has brought in. So let's do that. So instead of R, I can put 1. Instead of S, I can put 2. Instead of P, I can put 4. And instead of Q, I can put 3. And I could do it the other way around as well. And what do I get? I get exactly that ordering. So this mapping has preserved my ordering. So there's one bit of our isomorphism that you understand quite well now. Unordered set, 24 mappings with one-to-one correspondence. I bring in an ordering relation on them. I take one of my mappings with one-to-one correspondence and it preserves this ordering. I'm going to clean the board because I need quite a bit of space. We're going to move on to the next bit of this isomorphism. Good, so here we are with the next part. So again, I'm starting with my two unordered sets, A1 and A sub 1 and A sub 2, or unordered again, remember 1, 2, 3, 4, PQRS. And I have these two binary operations on them. These two binary operations. And the way these two binary operations are set up is this table. And how do we read this table? So we would have the following. So 2 with 2, this binary operation with 2, and 2 is going to give me 4. And on this side, say Q and R, Q and R, that gives me Q, and R gives me another Q back. I've set up two binary operations, one for each of my set. Remember that I still have this ordering relation. I just want to bring this back. So I have this ordering relation, one. This, remember, was divides, 1 divides 2, 2 divides 4, and 1 divides 3. And this one, I'm going to call it my relation prime, R to S to P, and R to Q. I've set up these two orderings. Something, just let's put that in. So if I have U and V as elements of A sub 1, and I have X and Y, elements of A sub 2, with this one-to-one correspondence, U to X, V to Y, which is what we've done with our one-to-one correspondence mapping, which was on the board previously, then if I have this relation between these two, that would imply this relation between these two, depending on this one-to-one correspondence. That's what we saw. So we've dealt with relations. What we are doing now is we're moving on to binary operations. So we set up these binary operations. And imagine now I have the following of one of my 24 mappings, which have a one-to-one correspondence. So 1 to R, 2 to S, 3 to Q, 4 to P. Now we can well say if we do this to this, if I put R in there, I have R. If I put 2 in there, I'll have S. If I put 4 in there, I'll have P. And if I put 3 in there, I'll have Q. So this holds. So this mapping that leads to one, this mapping with one-to-one correspondence, it is going to preserve my ordering relation. What does that do to my binary operations? So let's say, for instance, we take on this side, we take 2 and 3. So 2 and 3, what is that going to give us? Well, 2 and 3, that binary operation gives me a 1. And let's look if we map this. 2 maps to S, and 3 maps to Q. And that better give us R. And that better give us R. So I've got S on this side, Q on that side, and that binary operation gives me R. So what have we got here? We've got an isomorphism between my sets A sub 1 and A sub 2. What has happened? I've set up an ordering relation. I've got this mapping with one-to-one correspondence. It preserves not only my ordering relations, but it also preserves my binary operations. And if we have those two together, we have an isomorphism between sets A sub 1 and A sub 2. Not only the sets there, but what goes with the sets, the relations and their operations. So two algebraic systems. So algebraic system A sub 1 and A sub 2 are isomorphic. What I can do with the one implies what happens to the other one. I've preserved my relations and my binary operations. So there you have it, an isomorphism between two algebraic systems. As I say, you've got nowhere to go hang this knowledge. We haven't looked at groups or anything yet. But put this inside of your toolbox. Understand this concept of isomorphisms between two algebraic sets. And we're going to see it again in the future.